One little, two little, three little angels. Four little, five little, six little angels. Seven little, eight little, nine little angels. 10 little angels.
What do they do?
Watching us.
Okay, hey, Piper, hold up your sign. You say it after me.
Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid.
And Piper, Peyton, hold it high.
I bring you joy. I bring you joy. Yay!
He just listened to one of my prayer because he said, Jesus, hear me when I pray for my brother.
Jesus, hear me when I pray for my dolly.
Jesus, hear me when I pray for my mom and dad.
Jesus, hear me when I pray for my food.
Just listen for my clothes.
Did I hear me when I pray for my friend?
Jesus hears me when I pray for my toys.
Jesus hears me when I play for my film.
Jesus hears me when I play for my
Jesus, hear me when I pray for my soul.
Jesus, listen when I pray, when I pray, when I pray. Jesus, listen when I pray, every night, every day. Jesus, listen.
We love you, God. We want to say thank you.
Thank you for alligator and apple.
Thank you, God, for dinosaur and dog.
Thank you, God, for octopus.
Thank you, God, for the one zippo.
Thank you, God, for xylophone and X-ray.
Thank you, God, for ice cream and beets.
Thank you, God, for mouse.
Thank you, God, for owl.
Thank you, God, for peacock and pig.
Thank you, God, for robot and the Easter Bunny.
Thank you, God, for a horse and a house.
Thank you, God, for a clown.
Thank you, God, for baby Jesus.
Hi, God, with the rainbow in the sky. Hello, be love, that's why. Why does God make songs to the high? Hello, be love, that's why. Why does God give them to the hug? Why does God betray new us? Why does God make the rainbow in the eye? Hello, be love, that's why.
For watching TV.
having patience for eating food.
I'm joyful for Jesus.
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 I am joyful for Jesus.
I'm joyful for Jesus.
The joy, 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 down in my heart. We're down in my heart. We're down in my heart. I got the joy, 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 down in my heart. We're down in my heart to say.
How can you shine for Jesus today?
Smile and wave.
I can say good morning. Good morning.
Hi, I can say hi. Hi, how are you?
Hi, I'm great. Thank you for asking.
Can I introduce myself? Hi, my name is... What's your name?
Hi, mine is... Nice to meet you.
I can't be kind. Are you okay?
Yes, thank you for asking me.
You're welcome.
I cannot sound to play soccer. Hi, would you like to play soccer?
I'd love to. Let's go.
I can make a card. I'm going to make a card for my sister.
That's a good idea. I will too.
I can help a friend.
I found this lost glove. Is it yours?
Yes, thank you. I've been looking for it.
I can say kind words. Happy birthday. Hope you have a good day.
Thank you. I will.
I can pray for others.
Please be with the people who are sick.
And nurses and doctors. Amen.
Even the smallest actions have a ripple effect on so many others.
Light one candle for hope, one bright candle for hope. He brings hope to every heart. He comes, he comes. Light one candle for peace, one bright candle for peace. He brings peace to every heart. He comes, he comes. Light one candle for joy, one bright candle for joy. Every nation will find salvation through Bethlehem's baby boy.
Today we are going to learn that God is our refuge, the Lord is our rock, our fortress, and our deliverer. We will be looking at a very special story from Jesus' life when his parents had put their trust in the Lord to help them with a very difficult problem. We can also put our trust in the Lord for anything. Let's begin with the book of Psalms and see what David said about the Lord.
Psalm 18, verse 1 through 3. I love you, O Lord.
my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer. My God, my rock, in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised, and I am saved from my enemies.
There are four I will statements in these verses. What are they? Number one, I will love. Number two, I will trust. Number three, I will call. Number four, I will be saved. Why do you think David said these things to the Lord? Perhaps he said these things in response to the Lord's great promises. Let's look at what the Lord promises here. He promised we are, number one, strength. Number two, rock. Number three, fortress. Number four, deliverer. Number five, shield. Number six, stronghold.
Who is our enemy? Satan. If God promises that he is all of these things for us, what can Satan do to us? Nothing. If God is for us, who can be against us? Romans chapter 8, verse 31. The Lord is our rock, our fortress, and our deliverer. Who should we turn to when we have problems in our life? We need to turn to the Lord, who is our refuge. We can always trust in him to help us in our time of need. Let's turn to Matthew, where we will learn about two very obedient people who trusted God's word at a difficult time. We'll see how the Lord delivered them.
Now when they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Rise, take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt and remain there until I tell you, for Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him." And he rose and took the child and his mother by night and departed for Egypt.
Remember when the wise men came and visited Jesus and bought him gifts? Afterward, the wise men went back home without telling Herod where Jesus was. This made Herod very angry. He wanted to kill Jesus in order to keep Jesus from becoming king. Now an angel came to Joseph in a dream. The angel told Joseph to take the child and Mary and flee to Egypt. What is in Egypt? Egypt was the country to the south of Israel that God used Moses to deliver his people from in the Old Testament. Obediently, Joseph took Mary and Jesus and fled to Egypt. The Lord protected them and delivered them from their enemies because the Lord is a rock, a fortress, and our deliverer.
What exactly does it mean that the Lord is our rock, our fortress, and our deliverer? Oftentimes in the Bible, we see the Lord referred to as a rock. What can you think of that is stronger than a large rock? There is not much that can happen to a rock. God is very strong, and we can be sure that nothing will happen to him. When people build a house, it is important to build it on a strong foundation. That is why houses are built on rock and not sand.
Jesus told a story about a wise man who built his house upon the rock, and a foolish man who built his house upon the sand. When the storms came, the foolish man's house was washed away. We need to be wise and build our lives on the solid rock, Jesus Christ. Jesus is all rock. He is all firm foundation upon which we can build a very blessed life.
When you think of a fortress, it is kind of like a big fort, or maybe even like a castle. A fortress is made for defense from enemies. We have an enemy, the devil. We put our trust in the Lord. We will protected from our attacks of the enemies in our lives. There is only one way to enter into a fortress, and there is only one way to the Father, through Jesus. Jesus said,
John 14, verse 6, Jesus said to him, I am the way and truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me.
God is also our deliverer. He will rescue us and help us when we are in trouble. Just like God used Moses to deliver the children of Israel from slavery in Egypt, Jesus has come to deliver us from sin, death, and the devil. All we need to do is to put our trust in him. He delivered Joseph and Mary from King Herod, and he will deliver you and me from our enemy, Satan. Isn't it wonderful that our Lord is our rock, our fortress, and our deliverer?
Matthew 2, verse 14 through 15. And he rose and took the child and his mother by night and departed to Egypt and remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet, out of Egypt I called my son.
Joseph, Mary, and Jesus stayed in Egypt until Herod died. While they were there, the scripture was fulfilled that the prophet said that the Messiah would come out of Egypt.
When Israel was a child, I loved him, and out of Egypt I called my son.
Dear God, thank you for your purposes and plans. You are always present and work, even when things seem bad or difficult. Help us to trust in you and to trust in you. We love you, God. Thank you for Jesus. In his name, amen.
Oh, God, be faithful, joyful, and triumphant. Oh, come, we go to heaven for help. For the King. Christmas, we wish you a Merry Christmas, we wish you a Merry Christmas, and a Happy New Year. Good tidings we bring to you and your kin. Good tidings for Christmas and a Happy New Year. We wish you a Merry Christmas, we wish you a Merry Christmas, we wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
Merry Christmas!
Good night, manger.
Stars are twinkling, baby's fed, and Mama says it's time for bed.
Help can squeeze him, hold him tight. Dim the lantern, say goodnight.
In the manger, baby goes, wiggle finger, wiggle toe.
And in donkey, gather round. Hush, says Papa, not a sound.
Look, he's cute, oh yes, hee-haw. Now sleepy baby starts the wah!
Says donkey, time for bed. Here's a pillow for your head.
And has feathers soft and brown. Baby grabs them and snuggles down.
Soon Hosanna overhead, awake the little sleepy head.
Angels fill the time with joy. Meet this precious baby boy.
Mama said be quiet, please. Your voice is carrying on the breeze.
How rats baby to and fro? Does he slumber? No, no, no.
Baby smiles, baby starts stretching your rubbing eyes.
Mama says, here's what we'll do, sing a quiet song or two.
Baby sleeps as stars on high twinkle to the lullaby.
Good night, manger, good night, star. Time to sleep now, one and all.
This is an acrostic poem about humility.
H is for honoring God above yourself.
I am the Lord's servant, Mary answered, may a word to be fulfilled that the angel left her. Luke 1, verse 38.
U is for understanding your need for grace.
For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. Romans 12, verse 3.
And M is for mourning over your sin.
And I said, woe is me, for I am lost. For I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts.
Isaiah 6, verse 5.
Eyes for illuminating God's glory.
Nor shall you be called instructors, for you have one instructor, the Messiah. The greatest among you will be your servant. For those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. Matthew 23, verse 10 through 12.
L is for looking for ways to serve others.
Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Philippians 2, verse 3 through 4.
I is for ignoring pride and the devil's lies.
Humble yourselves in the presence of the Lord, and he will exalt you. James 4, verse 10.
T is for trusting God's plan over your own.
He leads the humble in what is right and teaches the humble his way. Psalm 25, verse 9.
Y is for yearning to worship.
To sum up, all of you be harmonious, sympathetic, brotherly, kind-hearted, and humble in spirit. 1 Peter 3, verse 8.
Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, taking the very nature of a servant. He humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Philippians 2, verse 5 through 8.
Yeah.
Myrrh is an odd gift for a baby, like frankincense. It was a spice mixture made from tree sap.
While it could be burned as an incense or used for medicine, it was used most commonly as a perfume and anointing oil combined with spices to prepare bodies for burial.
This expensive gift meant that the wise men knew this was the birth of the promised Christ child born to be Savior.
From the very beginning, this was his purpose, to give his life as a ransom for many. Matthew 20, verse 28.
In John 12, verse 27, just before Jesus went to the cross, he prayed,
"Father, save me from this hour, but for this cause came I unto this hour."
Jesus lived with awareness of his purpose. He was born to die.
The story of the Magi is the central part of the celebration of Christ's birth.
But when the Magi presented myrrh to the baby Jesus, they gave him a gift that honored his death.
We celebrate Christ's birth because of his death. Were it not for his death, his birth would have little meaning for us.
Yet Jesus came to conquer sin, came to die and freedom win.
Yes, he did.
G is for God.
Who shows us his love.
O is that special one.
Sent from above.
D is that special day.
God sent his son.
S is for shepherds.
And for angels' songs.
G is gifts.
That great wise men did bring.
I is for the inn.
Where they worship the king.
F is for forgiveness.
God's gift is for us.
T is for thank you.
For giving us.
Jesus. Yes, he did. bad king. I like to control most everything. Judea is the place that I rule. Everyone knows that I'm cool.
King Herod thinks that he is best. King Herod thinks that he is best. Well, one day some wise men came, asking about a king who was a babe. These wise men traveled from afar, just following a silly star.
This can't be, I'm the only king. Gifts to me these men should bring.
King Herod thinks that he is best. King Herod thinks that he is best. Herod called chief priests and scribes.
Tell me what has been inscribed.
Judah, ruler born Bethlehem, prophets say to shepherd them. King Herod, the mad and furious, exploded with anger and was jealous. King Herod thinks that he is best. King Herod, he is jealous.
Send the wise men on their way.
Come back here so I can pray.
Wise men left and never came back. Herod really blew his stack. Herod knew that he was a fool. He had all boys killed under two.
So what can we learn from this evil king? Jealousy only sadness brings. Jealousy only sadness brings. Jealousy only sadness brings. So our true king is Jesus Lord. Be content, read God's word. Be content, spread the word. Be content, spread the word!
Mary and Joseph had to obey the custom and take the child Jesus to Jerusalem to present him before God.
They brought two doves to offer as a sacrifice, just like the law said they had to do. While they waited their turn, a man named Simeon approached them.
God had guided him to the temple on the same day. God told Simeon he wasn't going to die before he saw Jesus, the special baby, the Son of God. Simeon was so happy when he saw Jesus. He even held him in his arms. He left the temple with joy in his heart.
A woman named Anna approached Mary and Joseph. She had worked day and night in the temple serving God. She also recognized who Jesus was, and she was very happy to see him. She left the temple to tell everyone the good news of Jesus' birth.
Mary and Joseph did what they had to do to follow the law, and then they went home.
With the love and care of Joseph and Mary, Jesus grew strong and wise. He experienced God's favor.
Simeon's song, also known as the Nunc Dimittis, is found in our Lutheran liturgy as a post-communion canticle. Lord, now let your servant depart in peace.
At first glance, it appears that we are taking the words of Simeon completely out of context. After all, what does this experience have to do with ours?
How can the Holy Communion ever compare to Simeon's unique honor of holding the infant Jesus in his arms during child's first visit to the temple at the tender age of 40 days.
Of course, we would love to have been in the temple and shared in the experience with Simeon. For that matter, we would give anything to have been the first, along with the shepherds, to see the infant Jesus, or to have been with the Magi as they offered their gifts to him.
But as Martin Luther taught, we don't find Christ in those places. Through the events of his birth, conviction, and resurrection, our Lord has accomplished our salvation.
But the benefits of Jesus' saving and work, forgiveness, life, and salvation are given to us through his means of grace, his word, and sacraments.
We can't go back to stand with Simeon in the temple. The good news is that we don't have to.
So following communion, when we sing Simeon's ancient song of faith,
Lord, now let your servant depart in peace. Nothing could be more appropriate. Indeed, our eyes have seen his salvation. Better yet, we have tasted and seen that the Lord is good.
So, what could be better than holding the infant Jesus in our arms? How about eating and drinking his body and blood given for the forgiveness of our sins?
This truly is heaven on earth, because here we have Jesus and all his benefits.
David had courage to face Goliath because he had faith and trust in God that his life would be spared.
I have faith in my mom to help me when I'm sad and to help me have courage when I need it.
I can show faith by telling others about Jesus' story and how he tells us to have faith in us that we can do things even when we don't feel like it.
I know that sometimes people can get bullied, so what I could do is stand up to that bully, like in the picture where the girl is being pushed down and stood up for. Even if they are just being called names, still stick up for them. That is how we can show faith.
My picture represents how these two people, a police officer and the animal rescuer, have faith in the Lord our God protects them.
Jesus wants us to be kind to one another, so in my picture, Sarah's little brother has to have faith to help her through cyberbullying.
This is showing faith by keeping a secret. I am telling my secret to my best friend, and I ask her not to tell anyone. This is showing faith by trusting in my friend and God.
I have faith that God will give me the courage to talk about the Bible to non-believers.
A way you can show faith is trusting that God will keep his promises. The girl in the picture is praying that the flood will go away and that God will protect her family. So that means praying to God is a way of showing faith.
The army has to have faith that God will guide them and keep them safe.
When I test for a new belt in Taekwondo, I have to have faith in God to help me remember and get through the moves. I also have to have faith in my family members to encourage me to get better.
We have to have faith police will protect us from danger. In this picture, the policeman has arrested the criminal, and he has to have faith he won't get hurt doing so.
Going to a new school is a problem because you do not know anyone. Having faith that people will help you in a new situation is important.
Oh, God.
Hi there, we are the shepherds in Bethlehem. Shepherds are short for sheep herders. While Mary and Joseph were in a stable that night, the baby Jesus was born. Mary wrapped him in cloths and laid him in a manger. A manger is a wooden box that holds hay.
We didn't know anything about it until something magnificent happened. We were out in the field watching over our flock of sheep that night.
All of a sudden, an angel of God appeared to us. We were terrified.
The angel told us not to be afraid. That was hard, but we trusted the angel.
I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be signed to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths laying in a manger.
That was really cool, but then something else happened. Suddenly, a whole bunch of angels appeared with the first angel. They were all praising God and saying,
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests.
Well, we had to go find Christ the Lord. So I said, let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened.
So we went. We found the stable and the manger and the baby just as God had told us. We bowed down to worship him. It was wonderful. We will never forget the moment. On our way back to the fields, we couldn't help ourselves. We were telling anyone who would listen exactly what had happened, so they would hear the good news also.
What an honor to be able to tell everyone. I wonder why God would pick us to do that important job. We are so thankful that he did.
Jesus is called the Lamb of God. Maybe that is why Jesus' birth was announced to us first. So how do people in your time adore Jesus?
We attend worship services at church and sing praises to God for sending his Son to save us from our sin. Because of what Jesus did for us, we can live with him in heaven when we die. I love to tell others about what Jesus did for me.
We adore Jesus by reading more about him in the Bible. We also pray for a strong faith. God helps us in all that we do. We thank him and worship him for all that he does for us.
We can also praise and adore Jesus by serving him. By serving others, we can share the good news just like the shepherds did. Thank you, Jesus, for coming to earth to save us.
Angels, we have heard a cry. Sweetly.
In those days, Caesar Augustus issued the decree that the census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place for a while. Quirinius was the governor of Syria, and everyone wanted their own farm to register.
So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child.
People in the field pointed them where to be registered.
Go.
They registered with a census taker and then asked if they could have any suggestions on where to stay that night. The census taker said they should pray to go door to door. They tried multiple locations only to hear the same answer, but they were steadfast in their search for the shelter. Finally, some kind people let them stay in their car stable. And they gave them some firewood to burn for the night. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born. And she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the field nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of God shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests."
When the angels left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about."
So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger.
The very first Christmas didn't have stockings on the mantle, presents, or even a Christmas tree. Jesus is all that was needed to know, because he is the greatest gift that has ever been given.
What is prayer? Prayer is when you talk to God.
I pray in my house.
My room, church, school, outside, and anywhere.
In my bedroom.
I pray for a good day.
In my perspective, I think that prayer means we can ask God to forgive us, help the poor, or ask to heal the people that are hurt.
Prayer is a time to praise God, like saying thank you to God on Thanksgiving or just saying thank you to Him all the time. Prayer is also a time to just talk to God privately.
We usually pray for people in need or people we care about.
I pray for my family, friends, pets, and other relatives, and also people who don't believe in God. I hope that one day all people in Christ would believe in God.
Pray for my family or friends where they are in danger, trouble, or worried.
What is an example of prayer from the Bible? Stephen's prayer is one of the most important prayers in the Bible because it teaches us to be bold in our faith.
The best example of prayer in the Bible is Stephen's prayer. While they were stoning him, Stephen appealed, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." Falling on his knees, he cried out in a loud voice, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." And when he said this, he fell asleep.
Jonah got swallowed by a giant fish because he didn't go to the place God wanted him to go, and he was thrown in the water because the people were afraid. Jonah prayed while he was in the fish. God answered, and Jonah did what God wanted Jonah to do.
Dear God, thank you for this day. Please help us have a good day every day. Thank you for everything. And please help everyone through this pandemic. Amen.
Have you seen that guy that sits out in the desert and talks all day? Well, what do you know about him?
Well, I heard he's the Savior and he comes to rescue us.
I heard that he's strange.
I've heard he gives really good messages.
I've seen him dunk people into water. What's that all about?
I've heard he's God's chosen messenger, whatever that means.
All I know is that he's got crazy beard and eats bugs and stuff.
Maybe we should go check it out. He's right down the road.
Good idea. Let's see what he has to say.
Water, but one who is more powerful than I will come, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire!
So you are God's messenger.
I get it now.
So we are supposed to be watching for the real Savior then?
Yes, this is true.
John was the son of Elizabeth and Zechariah. They prayed for a child for a long time.
God heard their prayers and blessed them with the Son, and the angel told Zechariah to name their son John.
John the Baptist is the cousin of Jesus. As an adult, he spent most of his life in the wilderness and ate wild locusts and honey. Many people would come and listen to him talk.
He spoke about a Savior who had been born to save all people from their sins. He is best known for helping prepare the way for the ministry of Jesus.
Another thing John did was baptize people. He even got to baptize Jesus when he came. The heavens opened, God spoke, and the Holy Spirit descended in the form of a dove.
Our word to describe John is prudency.
Being prudent means being careful and wise.
One example of being prudent is spending your money wisely. Another example is to always be prepared and to think about the consequences of your actions.
John the Baptist was often thought to be the Savior because he was such a good speaker and baptized many people. He had to be very prudent when he told the people who he actually was.
He didn't want anyone to think he was Jesus. He knew there was only one Savior.
He was also very wise. He needed to show the people why they needed Jesus. He wanted to baptize people so the Holy Spirit would work in their hearts.
John the Baptist prepared the way for the Lord. During this Christmas season, we can prepare our hearts for the coming of Jesus.
We can do this by worshiping during Advent services, singing Christmas hymns, and reading about the birth of Jesus in the Bible.
John the Baptist was very prudent. He was careful and wise with his actions. He had a plan to teach people about the Savior, and he followed through.
John the Baptist was thrown in prison and killed for believing in God. He is a great example of how we can be loyal to God no matter what situations we face in our lives.
What is discernment?
Discernment is defined as the ability to notice the fine point details, the ability to judge something well, or the ability to understand and comprehend something.
The wise men had discernment. They knew that the star that appeared was a unique star from the birth of the Messiah. So they followed the star, and it led them to Jesus. God led them with the star.
What does it mean to be led by God?
We are God's children, so that means he is our Father, and we need to follow him.
In order to be led by God, we need to listen to his word and follow his commandments.
We follow Jesus' example so that those around us can see Jesus living in us.
How does God lead us?
God leads us by his word and his law.
God leads us by putting people in our lives to help guide us, like parents, pastors, teachers, friends, and family members.
God gives us experiences in life to help us come closer to him and follow his will.
Why should we follow God?
God shows us love and mercy, giving us a purpose to live and follow him.
He forgives us no matter what sin we have committed, as long as we confess what we have done, so we may have eternal life with him, so someday in heaven.
We should follow God because he's going to lead us down the correct path in life.
You've listened to the story when Mary heard from the angel Gabriel that she would be the mother of Jesus, the Savior of the world. At times during that announcement, Mary was troubled and tried to understand what the angel's words meant. She even asked, "How can this be?"
Gabriel left her with these words, "For nothing will be impossible with God." In awe and with trust, Mary replied, "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word."
Immediately after that account in Luke chapter 1, we read that Mary left her home and stayed for nearly 3 months with Elizabeth, Mary's relative, who would soon become the mother of John the Baptist, whose ministry prepared the way for Jesus.
But before we think ahead to John and to Jesus, let's think for a minute. Why did Mary go to Elizabeth? Imagine Mary had just been told she would become pregnant. And not just that, she would carry what would be the answer to all the world's questions, all the world's needs.
Was she questioning what just happened? How could she not be? Were others questioning her? Not everyone would easily believe that the Mary they'd known as a young girl or their neighbor or Joseph's fiancée would really be the mother of God's son. Was she wondering if she could really do what had been asked of her? There had to be moments where she lay awake feeling overwhelmed.
Can you and I relate to Mary? We know we can. We've questioned what just happened and what to do about it. We've felt the doubt in others' glances or words. We too have felt unsure, have lacked the confidence to do what we know God is asking us to do.
If we look back at Luke 1, we see that Mary knew she needed a mentor, someone who Mary not only looked up to,
but whom Mary knew would welcome her and love her sincerely and would walk right beside her.
Even more than that, we needed a mentor who stood firm on the words from 1 Chronicles 16, verses 11. Look to the Lord in his strength. Seek his face always. She found Elizabeth who guided her, not with her own wisdom, but through the understanding of God's.
Just like Mary, we face questions, insecurities, and situations that are completely new to us. Just like Mary, let us seek the Elizabeths in our own lives, mentors who are committed to us, and even more importantly, who themselves walk with our God. He holds the answers to all of our questions.
My parents are my mentors because they keep me out of trouble by helping me make good decisions.
My parents are my mentors because when I am down, they help me through my struggles.
My mom and my dad are my mentor by helping me and guiding me through Christ.
My mom is one of my mentors because she shows me what's right and wrong and helps me with things.
My mom is my mentor because she is always there for me and sets a good example for how I should carry out God's will for my life.
One of my mentors is my grandpa. He lifts me through hard times. I hope to do that to others.
My mentors are my friends because they bring the best out of me and I want to do that to others.
My mentors are my aunt and my friends because whenever I'm sad or far from God, they bring me closer to him and support me.
My parents are my mentors because anytime I go astray from the right thing, spiritually with God or in my everyday life, they lead me back to the right thing.
Two of my mentors are my dad and my coach. My dad is a mentor to me because he teaches me right versus wrong, and he will always help and support me through everything. And my coach is a mentor to me because he is a great coach and a great person.
Some of my mentors are my mom and dad because they help me pay attention in church to learn about Jesus. They also push me to do my best when I play my instruments. They help me when I need help with school or anything else. My grandparents are my mentors because they help me learn to be a good helper, and they also help me when I need help and when my parents aren't around.
My music teacher is one of my mentors because they would always help me through the music step by step and help me through the music by myself.
Place mentors in our own lives. We look up to them, not because they are perfect, but because they meet us where we are. They love us completely, and they walk beside us, guiding us as we learn. Most importantly, they look to the Lord and his strength in their own lives.
We are grateful for the example of Elizabeth and the presence of our own mentors. Know that today, God already has one person, perhaps more, in mind that he will bring into our lives who will need us to be like Elizabeth, a godly mentor.
This is Joseph.
He is a carpenter.
He has pledged to be married to Mary.
We join the scene of Joseph talking to a few of his friends in his carpenter shop.
Joseph, just what are you doing?
First you were engaged to be married to a beautiful young woman, and then she's found to be pregnant before your wedding day.
Can you spell scandal?
What are you going to do, Joseph?
Back then, that was a really serious situation for Joseph. In fact, it could be deadly.
It's true. All of it. But I did not want anything bad to happen to Mary, so I actually decided to divorce her quietly.
Yeah, back then, even if you were just engaged, you had to actually get a divorce to call off a wedding.
You guys are not going to believe what happened next. Well, one night, after I had made up my mind to divorce Mary, I had a dream. An angel from God appeared in my dream. The angel said to me,
Joseph, son of David, don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit.
That made me feel a lot better right there. Then the angel went on and said,
she will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins.
When I woke up, I knew that I couldn't divorce Mary. I mean, God was doing something wonderful through her. I knew exactly what I had to do.
What did you do?
I took her into my home to keep her safe. Now we are waiting for the Son of God to be born.
That shows a lot of integrity, Joseph.
Integrity? Maybe you're right. I'd like to say that God had a plan, and I just needed to have faith in his plan.
Joseph, it's time to go.
Well, guys, that's Mary. I've got to go. We're off to Bethlehem for the census.